my second vice president of Twitter, Taylor Robinson. She has been the second vice president since November of 2016. Thank you very much for joining us, Ms. Robinson. So, is school still effective? Are they calling for a massive demonstration for all teachers to come out? Aren't you affecting the teaching of students today?
Twitter has no control over the closing and opening of schools. That's up to
the Isn't that irresponsible to just have that attitude towards the teaching the teaching of our students?
Is it irresponsible that we continue to sit in schools that are some of them death traps, and we continue to stay there to do our due diligence and have done so? School reopened this too, and we had to negotiate with our members to stay in some of those schools that the minister said was open.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you, because the education minister was boasting about the number
Correct.
Of schools that were opening.
So last week you had a fire at Princess Dung RC. Yesterday we had another school condemned by OSH and closed. We haven't heard anything about that yet, and it's only one of a number. We have a number of schools that just enough is not being done to maintain the schools, and we ask our teachers to bear with the system because we are responsible and we want to make sure that the Major children get a good education. But how much of that are you going to take? This school I'm speaking about in the Victoria District, at the first week of school, the first day of school, tutor was present there with teachers and asked them to try and work up until when they couldn't. Yesterday they got the OSH report that stated that the school was to be shut immediately. Where are those students and teachers going to be placed? We have a lot of schools decanted, not repaired properly, painted over pigeon feces, etc., and school continuing as normal. The first week of school, we have principals asking teachers to walk with toilet paper and supplies, and principals taking money out of their pocket to provide what the employer should provide. And those are the conditions that our teachers and our students are involved in every day.
And apart from that, based on what you're saying, there's now the issue of these long outstanding negotiations,
Correct.
Which is at the very crux of this demonstration. Again, started in the area of the Banlara Promenade from 12:30. Tell us the route for this demonstration.
Well,
we're going to
be assembling on the Banlara Promenade outside of Shackle Street and Abercrombie. We're then going to go west along Independence Square, north of Edward Street, east along New Street, south along St. Vincent Street, east along Park Street, south along Frederick Street, then east along Independence Square North, south along Charlotte Street, and west on Independence Square South, and we're going to end right where we began.
And I suppose there will be some statements from the president of the association and so on. And just to look at some of the advance information, talking about 4 years being too long for these negotiations and so on. What is the real key issue, the key points that you would like to bring to our attention this morning?
All right. We feel disrespected. Our teachers feel disrespected. It would be somewhat bearable if the ministry was even putting people at their right salary scale as it is now. That is not happening in most cases. A lot of teachers are old arrears and back pay. They've not been upgraded. And it's very hard to live in these times on those salaries. And in 2015, under Mr. Dudai, second vice president, we submitted our proposals to the then CPO. We are in 2019 and we have not even received counter proposals. We have called, we have written to the CPO, we met with her and asked her when she could begin. She has continued to indicate that she's had no instructions. We wrote to the Minister of Finance asking him to give those instructions. He did not respond to our letter, so this is how we are at this juncture. We have eventually filed in the Industrial Relations Court a failure to meet and treat against the Minister of Finance, because the Education Access, he has a duty to treat with teachers on these issues, and he has not done so. We've also filed an Industrial Relations Action against the CPO. We are asking for our counter proposals and to commence. In 2015, when these things were filed under CPO, Ms. Lewis, in 2016, when this group of officers in Twitter came in, we met Mr. Beresford Riley. We are now on to third CPO. And in January of this year, this CPO indicated to us that she was just about to send our proposals to the other stakeholders to get feedback to give us counter proposals, which she promised we would have in 2 months. We wrote, we reminded, nothing has come to us as yet. So we've been very patient.
So just so I can understand you clearly, I don't want to misrepresent what you're saying. Since Mr. Dudai, who was not then president,
he was the second vice president.
Second vice presented the first series of proposals to the CPO. Then, mm-hmm. there has, in the intervening 4 years, there has not been anything regarding in relation to counter proposals.
No.
And as far and of course the CPO will say, well, she has to be advised by the finance minister, and there has been no communication with the finance minister either in relation to this issue.
We have written, he has not responded.
And therefore, what do you hope to achieve by this? Because it will be an accusation that you all are being very political at this time, because we are in election season. Now is the best time to rumble and make noise and back the government into a corner.
But we're not trying to back the government into a corner. We are asking for respect and trust too. We are not even saying conclude it now, because we haven't even begun. But at least have the dignity to respond to us and give us our counter proposal, so we know which one of those items you are willing to treat with. And then have the CPO in January promise that she would have subcommittees start work, so that when she gets those instructions, we would have already advanced some of the work. We were heartened by that. The subcommittee that has to treat with the market, the external market survey, has not commenced one meeting. So we are saying we have been holding out, we've been trying to keep our members at bay, but people are fed up and frustrated. And as I said, tied into that, we are not receiving our accurate salaries. No teachers on their accurate salary right now, even for what they should be paid.
Again, just because, correct me if I'm wrong, the last time that there was a settlement and an agreement, it sounded then that the executive of Tutor were very, very happy with that arrangement, with the negotiations, with what was signed on to as far as the various rates of salaries and so on. You're saying that today, not a single teacher is receiving that salary?
No, they're receiving, but every year, Fazir, you do staff reports and you're supposed to get increments. We have teachers who have not gotten their increments. You have teachers in the system who are called assistant teacher planning. They are unable to secure mortgages and loans, etc., because they consider temporary teachers. Until they are upgraded to T1 primary and in secondary school to the T3, they remain on the lowest rung of the ladder in terms of salaries. And this is money that they have already worked for and they have not received. We met with the Ministry of Education last week, and it was very sad to hear them say, well, we have allocations, but we don't have the money to pay these things. So people are saying, even if we got our arrears, we got our back pay, we got what is owed to us, then we might be able to survive. Everything has gone up in the time since we've negotiated and now, but our salaries have remained the same.
And how would you respond to those who will say that there are others in the public sector who are operating in far worse conditions salary-wise, and therefore the teachers should be happy at least you're getting something?
We're grateful to have half a loaf, but we are supposed to get our just due, and we feel for our other comrades, because everything goes up and the poor man's salary doesn't. How do you explain and how do you argue that you have raised and increased your pensions? You haven't even reached to get any pension yet, but people's day-to-day living has not been raised to those effects. Those parliamentarians make more money than all of us. We're the working poor. We work from paycheck to paycheck. Many a day I have teachers sitting in front of me in my office crying because they are waiting for an upgrade for 12 years, 10 years. We have UTT students, USC students. All we're asking for is give them their upgrade. At least they could have some permanent employment and they could secure a loan or a mortgage like anybody else. That's not happening. And then on top of that, you have even failed to give us counter proposals to show us, well, we know that we should negotiate with you, and this is what we've put on the table. Give us a little more time. That hasn't come. So
has there been any intervention by the education minister? Has there been any dialogue with the education minister that could be described as productive?
I can't say that has happened.
And as far as the discussion, so just so we can understand before we talk about what you hope comes out of the demonstration today, and if it turns out to be a significant demonstration, the OWTU have announced that they are lending their support to this action. But is the sticking point, therefore, the CPO or the finance minister?
Well, the CPO has argued that she has to wait on instructions from him. We are saying that she can also begin the ball rolling. Wait on her, but he has not even offered. And as I said, we wrote to him in July of this year, and we are in October. Not a response to even to say acknowledge letter, acknowledge.
So the letter wasn't even acknowledged?
Not even acknowledged.
So the demonstration takes place from 12:30 today on the promenade. We've given the route already. what is tutor hoping that this will trigger? What are you hoping?
We are hoping that those people, the principals involved in this negotiation, would understand that we are unsettled and we have been patient and calm enough, and we are ready to begin our negotiations. At least give us our counter proposals and a date to start, so that we would see that you're interested in us. You cannot say that the children are the nation's greatest resource and then you treat us and the children as if we are nothing. So we are saying we have been quiet enough, we have been patient enough, we have taken into consideration all the economics and the whole country at large, but it is time to give us what we need.
And if there is no favorable response from tutors' perspective, what happens next?
Then you may expect that tutors' general counsel will have another meeting and we will take direction from them. Maybe we will have to up the ante. But I can't say what it will be. I have to wait on instructions from my counsel.
Fair enough. And one must respect the process. We see what's happening in the San Juan market situation, where the regional corporation is accused of not following due process in raising that rent, hence the action that was taken, the injunction that was granted. But from your own point of view, how would you describe the teaching fraternity right now? Just as a final thought before we conclude our discussion this morning, Ms. Robinson, how would you describe the mood of the teaching fraternity?
Very disgruntled. We have been out in the field, and every teacher, whether they are members or not, they're disgruntled, they're demotivated, and they feel that they have been neglected for far too long. Not only on this, but I'm saying the conditions of our schools are horrible. Horrible. And the minister goes on TV and says that all is well, but all is not well. We have continually asked about maintenance programs. We have none. So that's why schools, check all of the schools that have gone down from the beginning of the term this term to now. You'll be very surprised that some of these very schools that he said were open with a coat of paint, as I'm telling you, I'm not making this up, over pigeon poop. There are rodents, there are a lot of unsafe conditions, and most of our schools are old, so the Prince System fire might be only one, because they have not had their electricals upgraded, something we've asked that they do regularly. So our teachers are there. This weather, most of our schools don't have air condition, so this heat is unbearable in most of these classes. And I'm not only arguing for our teachers, because when the students are unsettled, you've seen video, you've seen children actually taping now that rain is coming through their classrooms, no furniture. All of these things add to the stress of running and managing a school, because when students have nowhere to sit, then they're going to get into problems. It's chaos. So we need to do better in the education system, a whole lot better.
Thank you very much for taking the time to join us this morning. So a tutor on the march this morning with their demonstration.